Blink TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
EU suspends Mali development aid after coup. Pakistanis rally against possible reopening of NATO supply routes. And new fuel crisis in Egypt sets tempers off. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
The African Union mission spokesman said the Peace and Security Council will hold an emergency meeting to adopt measures on the unfolding developments in Mali following the military coup staged in the country.
Al-Mazni said the AU may propose an initiative on the situation in Mali in the next few hours. The coup dominated the European Foreign Ministers meeting.
Toppled Malian President Amadou Toumani Touré is safe and in good health, as confirmed by the head of the mutiny in Mali. The mutineers accused the man of failing to provide the military institutions with the necessary means to counter the Azawad National Liberation Movement in northern Mali. They further announced their time in power is transitional and hinges on the restoration of national unity.
We didn't come to remain in power for life, and this is my promise to the Malian people. Will it take 3, 6, or 9 months? It all depends on the infrastructure we are building. Once this is achieved, I will return to my old military post, and another person will come and complete the mission.
None of the African or Western capitals expressed support for the coup. On the contrary, the UN Security Council and the European Union condemned the coup and expressed concern over the future of the democratic experience in the country.
I begin by saying to you that we deeply regret and condemn the coup d'etat in Mali. We remain in close contact with the people there, and we do hope the constitution will be restored very quickly and that we will see a return to law and order. We've been working with the countries of the Sahel, and our overall strategy will be discussed today, but obviously this will have changed the nature of the debate.
The members of the Security Council call for the immediate restoration of constitutional law and the democratic elected government. They also call for continuing and preserving the democratic process as previously agreed upon. They also urge all parties to exercise maximum restraint and refrain from violence.
Amadou Toumani Touré is to Mali and the southern African Sahara region what Siwar al-Dahab is to Sudan and the Arab world. He relinquished power 1 year after staging a coup. Touré's mission was not spared from criticism, especially with the Azawad rebelling for the third or fourth time and the army expressing resentment over what considers a failure to deal with such a rebellion. It seems the new coup will only weaken the democratic experience in the country.
Top story. Thousands of mourners in Bahrain have attended the funeral of a woman killed by Saudi-backed forces. Bahrainis are mourning a 59-year-old woman who died after inhaling tear gas fired by regime forces on protesters. She is the latest victim of the brutal crackdown on anti-regime protesters. Meanwhile, in the town of Deraz, protesters have taken to the streets calling on the government to prosecute those who demolished mosques. Dozens of mosques and religious mourning halls have been destroyed. Since mid-February last year, scores of Bahrainis have been killed and thousands arrested by the regime forces. Earlier, Saeed Shahabi from the Bahrain Freedom Movement in London gave us his take on the latest developments in Bahrain.
The ruling family is unable to do anything positive. So all in all, the people are aware today that they cannot achieve anything positive in terms of political reform, social justice, end of human rights abuses. Nothing of this sort has happened. So for the revolutionaries, they are justified in their action against the Al-Khalifa ruling family and the Saudi occupation by arguing to the world that, look, 1 year after the revolution, and this regime has failed to adapt any sort of real political reform. We are still living under his dictatorship. The ruling family is still controlling everything, and the repression continues, as has been manifested today by the martyrdom of the latest victim, who is a woman in her 50s.
Also in the news, thousands of Yemeni protesters have hit the streets across the nation to push for their revolutionary demands. Protesters held rallies after the Friday prayers in several major cities, including Sana'a, Taiz, and Aden. Demonstrators say they can no longer put up with the way things are run in their country. They say the situation will not get better until members of the old regime are purged from power. Demonstrators also urge the trial of the former ruler Ali Abdullah Saleh and his aides. They say Saleh is responsible for the deaths of thousands of protesters since the revolution began last year. In Jordan, protesters have held a massive rally in the capital Amman, calling for more reform. The protesters say they want an end to corruption. They're demanding investigations into corruption charges of senior government officials. They also want the government to start creating jobs. Protesters in Jordan have been hitting the streets on an almost weekly basis since last year. Back in October, demonstrators forced the resignation of the prime minister. Demonstrators intensified their rallies, calling for more change. In the headlines today, people in several cities across Pakistan have rallied against any government decision to reopen supply routes for the U.S.-led foreign troops based in neighboring Afghanistan. Pakistan's main religious parties, Jamaat-e-Islami and Difa-e-Pakistan, have warned Islamabad against allowing the supply lines to resume.
The purpose of the protest is to give a message to Parliament, government and political parties that NATO supply must not be restored for any reason. Restoration of NATO supply is against the solidarity of Pakistan, against the existence of Pakistan, and is a conspiracy against Afghanistan. This is why we demand that Pakistan should not restore NATO supply, and the proposal in the Parliament must be rejected so that there is peace in Pakistan and the world.
Islamabad closed the routes after a U.S. airstrike killed over two dozen Pakistani soldiers near the Afghan border in 2011. Pakistan also shut the Shamsi air base to U.S. forces. Anti-U.S. sentiments are high in Pakistan over the American drone attacks, which have killed large numbers of civilians during Barack Obama's presidency.
The fuel shortage crisis in Egypt has been exacerbated, halting traffic in the capital Cairo and a number of other cities after vehicles parked in front of petrol stations formed long queues. For its part, the People's Assembly held the Egyptian government responsible for the crisis and the failure to solve it. More details in this report by Omar Jamil from Cairo.
The scene repeats itself for the second time in less than 1 month. Long queues, arguments, traffic congestion, and a rise in the price of essential goods. Despite the differences of opinions, these views reflect the impact of the fuel crisis in a number of Egypt's provinces.
People have been on the street this whole week because of the diesel and fuel.
I wake up early to come here. I swear we've been here since 7 this morning and we'll probably stay until very late.
The station has gas, but I can't reach it. God willing, we'll get there.
During a rowdy People's Assembly session, the petroleum minister said the crisis is caused by chronic problems, but members of parliament, who submitted 70 requests for information on the petrol shortage, rejected the government's justifications. They confirmed it is unable to solve these crises.
The crisis was not born during this government. The crisis is several years old. We need to deal with 3,500 gas stations. I tell you, there is a plan, but to completely solve the crisis, we need more help.
The minister cleared himself and condemned his government. He said the funds are available and the product is available. So who is the problem? The assemblies the problem?
These crises are fabricated. This government is creating these crises for us. This is unacceptable. Unacceptable.
However, others refused to hold the government completely responsible and considered other causes for the crisis.
The reasons of the crisis are the government deficit and many other reasons in controlling the thugs and the distribution, in addition to a lack of resources. Also, there is an inability to confront the street, the inability to face the consumers and tell them the truth. The second reason is that the People's Assembly is aware of all these reasons, but is resorting to creating doubt. The third reason for the crisis is psychological. As soon as Egyptian citizens hear news or a rumor or any information, they start to flock to make sure that they can guarantee goods for themselves.
According to official figures, Egypt consumes 34,000 tons of diesel fuel on a daily basis, while it produces 22,000 tons. This means it needs to import 12,000 tons every day to cover its basic demand. The recurring petrol shortages in Egypt no longer only impact the economy and society, but are now affecting the political scene as pressure on the Genzouri government increases. At the same time, citizens still ignore the real reasons behind these fuel crises and how they get solved. Omar Jamil, BBC, Cairo.
The Syrian regime's army launched a wide-scale military operation near the Turkish border, targeting cities in the provinces of Idlib and Aleppo. Today, the artillery shelling was concentrated on the city of Banash, forcing thousands of residents to flee the area. Meanwhile, fierce clashes erupted between regime forces and army defectors in the city of Azaz in the countryside of Aleppo, killing three regime soldiers. For days, the city of Azaz has been witnessing heavy shelling, with the regime's army helicopters continuing to patrol its skies. Today, activists announced the deaths of 9 people across various Syrian regions. Like every Friday, Syrian activists staged anti-regime protests. Today, they called for demonstrations under the slogan, "Damascus, we are coming," in solidarity with the Syrian capital. 1 year after the launch of protests against Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's regime, violence has reached the capital, where nighttime clashes are continuing to rage between the regime's forces and army defectors. Amid these developments, the joint UN Arab League Special Envoy, Kofi Annan, continues to look for a solution to the crisis. Annan's spokesman said the UN envoy will travel to Russia and China next Sunday to discuss the Syrian crisis. He added that the team sent by Annan to Damascus to follow up on the proposed solutions offered to the Syrian regime has completed its mission in Syria. The international relief workers who were allowed to take part in a delegation led by the Syrian government to assess the humanitarian situation in Syrian cities still have limited access to battered areas. UN humanitarian chief Valerie Amos said that relief agencies have limited access to needy people inside Syria. She added that they are currently able to provide limited food, health, and hygiene support inside Syria. Amos warned of a continuing deterioration in Syria amid the ongoing fighting and violence inside Syrian cities, including Damascus. The EU imposed a new round of sanctions on Syria. The sanctions were approved by UN foreign ministers against 12 Syrian figureheads, including President Bashar al-Assad's family. The objective is to mount further pressure on the Syrian regime to end the violence. The sanctions include the president's wife, Asma al-Assad, his mother, sister, sister-in-law, and other family members. The European ministers also decided to freeze the assets of other Syrian officials and placed a Europe travel ban on them. They also barred European companies from entering in contracts with Syrian entities.
A Sudanese parliamentary delegation toured the state of South Darfur to review security developments and living conditions in areas affected by the war. In statements issued to Al Alam, members of the delegation said improvements in the security situation in the region after signing the Darfur peace agreement pushes the state to implement large development projects.
The Sudanese parliament is overseeing changes in the state of Darfur to evaluate the situation on the ground. It started by touring a number of areas in the state of South Darfur to look into the condition of the citizens and the security situation in the areas impacted by the war in Darfur. The aim is to start development projects in the region.
We are aware that security is important for development. When there is security, there will be development, and the opposite is also true. In the past, we had different excuses, but we now view the time as right to develop this region, especially with large projects and by investing in this state. It's true that the projects we've implemented have not met our ambitions.
During the parliamentary delegation's visit to the area, members looked into the implementation of national projects in the states of Darfur after achieving peace in this region. Maintaining that peace requires urgent intervention by the Sudanese government and direct follow-up.
We looked into development issues and public services. We found the issue to be complicated in the regions of the state. So we're now trying to improve the development projects, but many, many factors impact this work, including war and the security situation. God willing, investments will continue in the state, and it will be further developed after security is improved.
Different positions were expressed by the political parties in Darfur in light of the numerous states and local issues as funding remains limited. Citizens listed their demands to the Sudanese parliamentary delegation. They expressed the need to have responsible parties play their role in reviewing the work of the Sudanese government's institutions, which are overseeing the implementation of the Western Development Project that is crucial for Darfur. The improvement of security in Darfur was revealed to the Sudanese parliamentary delegation to the region as the implementation of national projects remains uncertain. This could jeopardize security in Darfur. Ashraf Omar, Al Alam, South Darfur.
Open with emerging details of the investigation into the Algerian-born French terrorist Mohamed Merah, who killed seven people over the past 2 weeks before dying in a hail of gunfire in Toulouse yesterday after a 30-hour standoff with French security forces. Evidence gathered by forensic police today continued at the bullet-ridden apartment of the 23-year-old gunman who, before his death, confessed to killing three Jewish children, a rabbi, and three French paratroopers. Videotapes filmed by Merah during the murders were also discovered, including a horrific sequence where he shot 7-year-old Miriam Monsonego in the head at the Ozara Torah school earlier this week. French media today reported that Merah's passport contained border stamps from Israel and that he may have attempted to enter Palestinian areas of the West Bank, claims now under investigation by Israel's General Security Services. According to a senior French intelligence officer, Israeli police questioned Merah in 2010 after he was found in possession of a knife. Other countries included in Merah's tour of the Middle East include Syria, Jordan, Iraq, and Afghanistan, where he trained at al-Qaeda camps. U.S. officials have confirmed that Merah was placed on a no-fly watch list and forbidden from entering the United States or flying on American Airlines. Psychiatric reports released on the gunman today revealed that he had been committed to a mental health facility for 2 weeks after attempting suicide by hanging. Merah had an extensive criminal record as a juvenile offender and served an 18-month prison term for aggravated robbery. Residents of Toulouse from all backgrounds and faiths gathered in the city center today, where they remained silent for 1 minute in memory of those killed in the terrorist attack. Participants carried numerous banners, including those which expressed unity among people of different faiths. One read, "Jewish, Christian, Muslim, same God, same love." Here in Jerusalem, President Shimon Peres today paid a condolence call on the Sandler and Monsonego families who lost their loved ones in the Toulouse terror attack. Yaakov Monsonego, whose daughter Miriam died in his arms, told the president that an even greater tragedy was prevented at the Ozara Torah school where he serves as principal. A van parked in front of the school synagogue impeded the gunman's entry, where Monsonego said that he believes Merah planned to open fire on dozens of additional children. Peres told the widow of Rabbi Jonathan Sandler, who lost not only her 30-year-old husband, but two sons, 3-year-old Gavriel and 6-year-old Arye, that it is impossible to comprehend the madness and cruelty behind the murders. In other news, fierce reaction from Israel today to the decision from the United Nations Human Rights Council to send a fact-finding mission to investigate the impact Jewish settlements have on Arab residents of the West Bank, Golan, and Gaza. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu called the council hypocritical, while Foreign Minister Avigdor Lieberman not only announced that Israel will not cooperate with the mission, but said that he will attempt to convince other nations, including the United States, to withdraw from the council that he branded as ridiculous and irrelevant. The UNHRC resolution passed overwhelmingly with a vote of 36 in favor, with just the U.S. voting against. The council also adopted 4 other resolutions at its 19th session in Geneva, highly critical of Israel.
The so-called Human Rights Council has a documented record of anti-Israel bias, of discriminating against the only democracy in the Middle East, against Israel, the only country that truly upholds human rights.
The supply of fuel into Gaza was resumed today through the Kerem Shalom crossing. Some 450,000 liters of gasoline and diesel purchased by the Palestinian Authority were delivered to the Hamas-ruled territory by 9 fuel tankers. Israel permitted the shipment in an attempt to stem the increasing energy crisis within the strip, which began over 1 year ago when Egypt cut off supplies following a dispute with Hamas. Cairo had insisted that the fuel be delivered into Gaza through Israel, an arrangement Hamas opposed over what the group claimed would be an opportunity for Israel to block supplies in times of tension. Over the past year, Hamas has been smuggling fuel into Gaza through underground tunnels, but supplies were down to a trickle last month following the critical shortage. Gas stations have run dry, and some 1.7 Gaza residents have experienced major electrical blackouts.
The official and popular preparations for the launch of the peaceful global march to Jerusalem have been completed. Islamic University students confirmed they will actively participate in the march despite Israeli threats to prevent the march from reaching the holy city. Ayman Alalul has the details.
On March 30th, and in observance of the 36th annual Land Day, the Global March to Jerusalem will be launched from around the world with the aim of reaching Jerusalem or the closest possible point to the Holy City.
There's broad international participation, including Arab and Islamic. God willing, they will hold massive demonstrations on Land Day. Similar rallies will be held at the same time in the Gaza Strip, Jerusalem, the 1948 occupied territories, and the West Bank. We are hoping to see massive rallies, powerful events, and successful results. God willing, all praise to Him.
The Islamic University in Gaza held a rally in solidarity with Jerusalem, and students announced their readiness to strongly participate in the march. The university students affirmed they will be ready on time to take part in the march. They will start their rally by heading to the northern borders of Gaza, where the enemy is expected to open fire at them.
من الاقتراب أكثر.
كانت هذه الوقفة للأخوات في مجلس طالبات الجامعة الإسلامية لأجل.
This rally was organized by our sisters from the Islamic University Students Union for the sake of our beloved Jerusalem and Al-Aqsa Mosque. We came out to condemn what's happening at the Aqsa Holy Land. If Jewish women are able to stand in the face of Palestinians, Arabs, and Muslims and tell them no, then we are much stronger and better candidates to take such action.
من أكثر من 80 دولة حول العالم.
With the participation of over 80 countries from around the world, including Arab countries surrounding Israel, the Global March to Jerusalem will be launched as scheduled. Some marches have indeed started to mobilize from a number of Asian countries. A large number of Indian participants have arrived in Iran to join the country's mass rallies in anticipation of heading toward Jordan. Malaysia announced that more than 200,000 citizens have decided to take part in the marches and head to the Palestinian borders.
We will not forget our Al-Aqsa that's suffering under the reign of the occupation. This student rally, which was organized under the slogan, O Jerusalem, we're coming, comes under the context of the global campaign to support Jerusalem. This campaign was organized by the National Committee of the Global Mobilization, scheduled for March 30, 2012, God willing.
The Islamic University in Gaza decided to take part in the Global March to Jerusalem with full force. This is the case of an individual Palestinian institution. Figures and indicators are showing that participation around the world will be massive, prompting the occupation to consider this action not once but 1,000 times.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Winco Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic. Channel of uncompromising stories, world news, documentaries, entertainment, and culture. Link TV, connecting you to the world. For more information, visit linktv.org.